Good morning. Mimi gave me these very helpful things that will hopefully keep the sheets down. Thank you. So kind. And thank you, praise team. You all do such a great job. And I'm blessed every time I'm able to come and worship with you all. You all do such a great job. Today, we're in a very precious scripture, one that's quite popular. If you're a good old Christian hipster, you might have this tattooed. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Christian families often have this hung up on their walls. To live is Christ and to die is gain. These are quite a few verses that I'm trying to tackle and get through today. So I'm not going to be going through every single word, as maybe sometimes you're used to with Pastor Greg. But instead, hopefully just get the essence of what Paul is trying to get across here. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. Because these words are so precious, I'm just going to read through it again and let Paul speak to us through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. This is 18b, actually. I skipped through 18a because I believe that it's a different thought in the first paragraph. We'll talk about that briefly a little later. Yes, and I will rejoice, for I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayers and the provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that I will not be put to shame in anything, but that with all boldness, Christ will even now, as always, be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me. And I don't know which to choose. But I'm hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that's very much better. Bad English, good Greek. Very much better. Yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that your proud confidence in me may abound in Christ Jesus through my coming to you again. Now let's pray before we get into this. Father, may the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. As we've gone through the book of Philippians, we've noted that the primary theme is spiritual maturity. Spiritual maturity. So in the first few verses, we've noticed Paul's prayer life. And he prayed for the maturity of the Philippian church. And then last time I spoke through verses 12 through 18, we talked about Paul's joy. How is it that Paul can experience joy in difficult circumstances? And as we went through, we looked to answer the question, how can we experience joy in difficult circumstances? We learned that Paul experiences joy despite his circumstances because the gospel is spreading outside the church and courage is being cultivated inside the church. And Paul experienced joy despite opposition because the glory of Christ is more important than his own. And of course, therefore, we learned that we can experience true joy despite difficult circumstances because we know that God can use these circumstances to advance the gospel, and we can experience true joy despite opposition because we understand that Christ's glory is more important than our own. In these next few verses, however, Paul shifts tenses. He explains why he will have joy. In verses 12 through 18, he talks about his current joy in current circumstances. Now he explains that he will rejoice and why he will rejoice. Paul continues to rejoice. As we go through our text today, there are four pillars of Paul's joy that I want us to look at. Four pillars of Paul's joy, and this will be our outline today. So if you're a note taker, you can write these down. It'll be brief. I'll go through them now, and I'll repeat them as I go along, so you'll get them as I go through. Four pillars of Paul's joy. Number one, he is positive that his circumstances will turn out for his deliverance. He is positive that his circumstances will turn out for his deliverance. Number two, his purpose in life is Christ. His purpose in life is Christ. Number three, his profit in death is to be with Christ. His profit in death is to be with Christ. And number four, his persuasion is that living or dying are both good options. He is positive that his circumstances will turn out for his deliverance. His purpose in life is Christ. His profit in death is to be with Christ. And his persuasion is that living or dying are both good options. First, Paul experienced joy because he's positive that his circumstances will turn out for his deliverance. Verses 18b through 19 read like this. Yes, I will rejoice, for I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayers and the provision of the Spirit of Jesus. Yes, I will rejoice. Now, we should understand that the verse numbers are not inspired. The chapter numbers, they're not inspired. They were added around the 14th century by a scholar who sought to simply make it easier for us to read the Bible. But they're not inspired in and of themselves. This is a letter. Paul is not writing in 2.1, 2.2. No, he's simply writing a letter. And later, these were added. And although they are extremely helpful, wow, I'm so glad they're there. There are times, I think, when they divide things where maybe it's not as appropriate as I'd like. But yes, I will rejoice, I believe, belongs with verse 19. I know this, I think this, because he continues in verse 19 with the word for, or because. He's explaining why he will rejoice, even in the midst of difficulties, and even as he faces possible death. In the previous paragraph, in verse 18a, Paul says, what then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in this I rejoice. Paul explained in verses 12 through 18a the reasons for his present joy. Now, starting in 18b, Paul shifts to the future tense. He says that he will rejoice. So why will you rejoice, Paul? And he answers, for I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayers and the provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Paul experiences joy because he's positive that his circumstances will turn out for his deliverance. What does this deliverance mean? What does deliverance mean here? It could mean that Paul is positive or confident in his deliverance from this situation, from his physical situation, from prison. If you remember, Paul is under house arrest and is chained to the guard, and he has been for 2 years. Some commentators believe that Paul is referring to his confidence that God will deliver him from prison and from death. And we do read in verse 25 that Paul is confident that he will remain and continue with the church. He was convinced that it was not God's will for him to die, but to continue in the ministry of the gospel. However, he still knew it was a possibility that he could die, because we read in verse 20, but that with all boldness, Christ will even now, as always, be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. Paul had in mind the possibility of death, though he believed he would be released. Others say that Paul is referring to his eternal salvation, that whatever happens on earth, he will be delivered into heaven. The original Greek word for deliverance we see here in soteria, and in other places is translated salvation, deliverance, rescue. And if you're familiar with systematic theology, soteriology is the doctrine of salvation, and this is where we get the word. I don't think we necessarily have to pick one of them. I think it's a little bit of both. Paul is declaring his trust in God's sovereign plan. No matter what happens, Paul trusts that in some way, whether he's delivered from prison, whether he's taken up into heaven, whatever happens, it will be for his good. Paul knows, as he's written elsewhere, that all things work together for good, for those who love God and are called according to his purposes. Paul trusts in the sovereign plan of God. Beyond this, Paul understands that his circumstance is temporary. His circumstance is temporary. He probably says something like this. He knows that he'll be delivered from it. He could be thinking, say something like this. Maybe I'll eventually be taken to trial and be released. Maybe I'll go on to heaven and be in the presence with Christ. Maybe God will keep my well-being safe throughout all of this. I don't know. But I do know that this is temporary. And I do know that the future holds my deliverance. And why is Paul so confident? Why is Paul so positive that this is going to happen? That his deliverance is going to be the result? Paul, how can you be so sure? And I think this is actually quite interesting. The statement he makes here, "For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance," or "this will turn out for my deliverance," is a verbatim quote of Job chapter 13, verse 16, in the Septuagint, or the Greek translation of the Old Testament. And Paul, as we know, is a scholar of Scripture, and obviously identified his own problems and his own struggle with that of Job. He knew the story of Job. All the Jews know the story of Job. And he knew that Job was a righteous man and that God put Job in a situation of suffering. But Job knew, because he knew God delivered the righteous, that no matter what he went through, God will deliver him out of it. Job knew that even to the point of death, where he said, "Though worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God." He knew that one way or another, either temporally or eternally, God would deliver him. Paul relied on the word of God during a time of crisis. He knew the word well. He knew it well enough to be able to recall the faith of Job in the sovereignty of God. And so we can rejoice, even in the face of death, for the same reason. Confident that if we face death because of righteousness, like Peter said, we can count it joy. We can rejoice because God will deliver us. He may deliver us temporarily. He may deliver us eternally, but he will deliver us. That's the promise of God's word. So he was confident in what God's word said, because he knew that God fulfills his promises. I know that this will turn out for my deliverance. Paul trusted in the sovereignty of God because of the promises of God, God's word, and he knew that God uses the means of prayer to bring about good. The means of prayer, which is the next part of this portion. Paul knew that God works through the prayers of his people, and he had seen it. He had witnessed it. In Acts chapter 12, verse 5, Luke writes, "So Peter was kept in prison, but earnest prayer for him was made to God by the church." And then in verses 6 through 11, Luke tells of the deliverance of Peter from prison. After Peter leaves prison, he visits the house of Mary, the mother of John Mark. And as he knocks on the door, he interrupts a group of Christians praying. Probably including in their prayers the deliverance of Peter. And there he was. No doubt Paul had heard about this. He knew the word of God would come to pass, and he believed the sovereignty of God. He also believed that God works his eternal purposes through the prayer of the saints, the prayers of the saints. And so he says, through your prayers. One of the most wonderful truths of Scripture is that God works his purposes through the prayers of his people. And he says to the Philippians, who loved him dearly and to whom he was bonded in a very unique way, maybe unlike any other congregation, as we pointed out earlier, he knew he had their prayers. Or we pointed out last time, he knew he had their prayers. And he knew that the effectual fervent prayer of righteous men produced much fruit and has great effect. He knew that God works his purposes through the faithful prayers of these people to bring his deliverance. He believed in prayer. He was confident in prayer. And he called people to pray on his behalf. Romans chapter 15, verse 30. "Now I urge you, brethren, by the Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit, to strive together with me in your prayers to God for me." He says, please pray for me. Do we pray for others as we ought? Do we pray for one another as we ought? I believe that we often think so lightly about prayer. Are we convinced, as Paul was, of the sovereignty of God? Do we trust his promises? Do we believe that God truly uses the prayer of the saints, the prayers of the saints, to work for the glory of God and the good of others? Paul will experience joy because he is positive that his circumstances will turn out for his deliverance because he trusts the sovereignty of God and he leans on the prayers of the saints. He trusts in the sovereignty of God and he leans on the prayers of the saints. Next, Paul will experience joy because his purpose in life is Christ. And this is where we get to that oh-so-famous passage in Scripture. We'll experience joy because his purpose in life is Christ. It's important to remember that the book of Philippians is a response to the generosity of the Philippian church to Paul. They send him a financial gift and one of their leaders, Epaphroditus, to encourage Paul while he's in chains. And I think it's very interesting. The church did these things to be an encouragement to Paul and to help him. And even while in chains, facing possible death, Paul in turn encourages them and helps them through this letter and through his example. Strange that the one who was intended to be comforted has in turn comforted them with these words. Another example of Paul not wasting time, not wasting suffering, but taking these opportunities to minister, to encourage, and to help. And he continues in verses 20 through 21. According to my earnest expectation and hope, that I will not be put to shame in anything, but that with all boldness, Christ will even now, as always, be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. And now some of the most popular words in all of sacred scripture. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Is this true of our lives? Can we say to live is Christ and to die is gain? This is the foundation of how Paul lived his life. In order for Paul to have such confidence, such joy as he faces possible death and inevitable suffering, it's because everything in his life was for Christ, not church, not work, not popularity, not reputation, but all for Christ. And he stated it similarly in other places of his writings. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 4, Paul says, Christ, our life. And in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, he says, I've been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. I want you to notice the personal touch of this statement here. For to me, Paul says, for to me. Paul has resolved, no matter what anyone else is doing around him, no matter what may be going on around him, he has resolved to live for Christ in everything that he did, no matter what the world says, no matter the newest trend, no matter who might tell him otherwise, Paul was resolved to live for Christ. And we can so easily be tossed by the waves of culture and entertainment. We can so easily be tossed by the temptations of prestige and fame, rather than giving everything that we are to Christ and his glory. And I think it's also interesting, when Paul says to live, I believe he's making a distinction between simply having life or having breath in your lungs and living with purpose. For to me, to live is Christ. What's dominant in my life? What's supremely important in my life? What is absolutely necessary in my life? What is driving my life? What sustains my life? What is most valuable to me? Not sitting back and going through the motions, letting life happen to you, but an intentional and passionate pursuit of Christ's glory in life. There is to be nothing in our lives that is outside our pursuit of living for Christ. To live is Christ. And I think it's also interesting. Paul's just an excellent writer, obviously through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Paul says, for me to live is Christ. And actually in the Greek, the verb is isn't there. The verb isn't there. It's put in by the translators to help us read it in English, because it makes sense in English. But in Greek, If you were to literally read this in the original language, it would say something like this. To live Christ. To live Christ. If you asked Paul about life, he would answer very simply, Christ. Life is all about Christ. He says it so emphatically. To live Christ. Why? Why is Paul so consumed with giving everything that he has in this life to serving Jesus Christ? Why is Paul so consumed with giving everything to Jesus Christ? And I think it's simply because he knows who he is. He knows who Jesus is. Who is Jesus? He's the way into salvation. John chapter 8, 24, Jesus says, "For if you don't believe in me, that I am he, you will die in your sins." John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus says, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." He says in John chapter 3, verse 36, "He who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides in him." He's the way into salvation. He's also a comfort in times of trouble. He says in John chapter 14, verse 1, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." John chapter 16, verse 33, Jesus says, "I've said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world." He's the way into salvation. He's a comfort in times of trouble, but he's also God in the flesh. This is why Jesus says to Philip in John chapter 14, "Have I been with you so long, and you still don't know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'?" Jesus is God visible. John starts his gospel with, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was nothing made that was made." In John chapter 8, 58, Jesus says to the Pharisees, they're curious, "How can such a young person know their father Abraham?" And Jesus responds, "Before Abraham was, I am." John finishes his gospel with the scene of Thomas finally seeing Jesus for who he is after all his doubting. He feels the wounds of Jesus and asserts with absolute confidence, "My Lord and my God." Hebrews 1 verse 3 says, "And he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature. He upholds all things by the word of his power." Jesus is the visible representation of the invisible God. What once was invisible can now be fully seen in Christ Jesus. He's also the sustainer of all things. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 17, Paul says, "And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together." And this in itself is a beautiful and humbling reality. There is not a second that goes by that we can rightfully say, "I did this or that," without the strength of Christ. He's holding you together. When you rise in the morning, he sustains you through the night. As you commute to work or walk to class, he provided the means. If things aren't going well and tragedy comes, as we sang today, he is still putting air in your lungs and is present with you in hard times. There's not a minute that goes by that we can say, "I did this," apart from the grace and love of Jesus Christ. He's holding you together. Those of us that have put our faith in Jesus Christ and put him at the center of our lives know that we have in Christ a magnificent treasure. Everything else in life is nothing compared to the treasure of knowing Christ Jesus. It's important also to remember, Paul didn't always live for Christ. In fact, he was living to antagonize those that were following Christ. It's not until Paul meets the risen Jesus in his glory on the road to Damascus, and it says in Acts chapter 9, verse 20, right after being converted and witnessing the risen Savior, the scriptures say that he immediately began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogues, saying he is the Son of God. A correct understanding of Jesus, an encounter with him, should directly lead to lives totally surrendered to his service. Yet many of us don't encounter him on a daily basis through daily study of his word. Some of us maybe don't give our lives to him because we don't rightly know who he is. I encourage you to read the Gospels, read Scripture, read the example of Jesus Christ, read the glory of Jesus Christ, the predictions of Jesus Christ, the strength of Jesus Christ, the comfort of Jesus Christ. Study them intently and become familiar with the person of Jesus Christ. Paul says, "For me to live is Christ." Can you say that this morning? Can you say this as a born-again Christian? Not that you're perfect, not that you have everything together, but that you can say that your life is Christ, not Christ and something else. Not Christ and your job, not Christ and your nice apartment, not Christ and your happy, comfortable life, but that your life is Christ. And if you can say that, there's joy on the other side. So Paul will experience joy because his purpose in life is Christ. Because his purpose in life is Christ. Now Paul will experience joy because his profit in death is to be with Christ. His profit in death is to be with Christ. Mr. Steve Cole used this as an illustration. I'm also going to use it. He's a pastor in the U.S. A young man came to W.E. Gladstone when he was Prime Minister of England. And he said, "Mr. Gladstone, I would appreciate your giving me a few minutes in which I might lay before you my plans for the future. I would like to study law," Mr. Gladstone replies. "Yes," said the great statesman. "What then?" "Then, sir, I would like to gain entrance to the bar of England." "Yes, young man. What then?" "Then, sir, I hope to have a place in Parliament, in the House of Lords." "Yes, young man. What then?" "Then I hope to do great things for Britain." "Yes, young man. What then?" "Then, sir, I hope to retire, take life easy." "Yes, young man. And what then?" "Well then, Mr. Gladstone, I suppose I'll die." "Yes, young man. And what then?" The young man hesitated and then said, "I guess I've never thought any further than that, sir." Looking at the young man sternly and steadily, Gladstone said, "Young man, you're a fool. Go home and think your life through." Many don't plan, consider, or think about what comes after death. Paul here does think about his death, mostly because he's facing the possibility of death. And I think it's fitting today that we look at Paul's view on life and on death, and Paul's joy in the face of possible death, because it seems that every single week we get reports of death tolls as they rise in various places throughout the world. And maybe the sheer number doesn't strike fear into your heart, but just they're there. And you get to see the numbers rising. And death is actually, it's something we all face and are affected by in life. Yet it troubles us to such a degree that often we're too uncomfortable to talk about it. I heard a shocking statistic once. This will blow your mind. Blew my mind. One out of every one person dies. Very shocking. It affects all of us, and yet we often don't talk about it. In college, our basketball coach, and you're like, "You played basketball? Your stature? Really?" It's confusing, I know. In college, our basketball coach every year had the seniors answer the question, "How do you want to be remembered when you die?" And I thought it was quite interesting, because prior to this, I never thought of death. However, Paul does think about death. You may be tempted to think that this is an escapist sort of view, to say that it's better to die, that to die is to gain. But I think we're going to learn today that the reason Paul is ready to die is the reason Paul is ready to live. His reasoning behind accepting death as a good option is exactly why he lived with so much passion and intensity for Christ. Paul is able to say the second half of this sentence because he's able to say the first and vice versa. If Christ is not your life, then to die is loss. You lose. If you live for anything else, for anyone else here on earth, then when you die, you lose that thing. However, if Christ is your total purpose here on earth, then things only get better when you enter into glory and the full presence of Jesus Christ. Paul explains this well later in the letter. In chapter 3, verses 7 through 8, Paul says, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I might gain Christ." And when he says to gain, he speaks here, or what he's losing here on earth, he speaks about, as you can tell, I'm struggling. I've tried not to mention it this far, but I'm struggling with the paper. It's all my fault. That really works well. Thank you, Mimi. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 through 8. And what he's talking about, what he loses here, what he counts as loss, is his heritage, his ancestry, his education, or his status. The moment he encountered the risen Christ, these things became nothing to him. Because when Christ is your purpose in life and death is gain, because you're immediately brought into the presence of the object of your life mission, the treasure of your heart, into the presence of Jesus Christ. If Christ is not your life and you live for anything else, then death can only be a loss to you. And Paul here says to die is gain. Again, in the original language, no is. To die, gain. To die, gain. To add emphasis. And this word gain means profit or benefit. For Paul, death is beneficial because it will usher him in to the immediate presence of Jesus Christ. That is heaven for Paul. The gain for Paul is not streets of gold or pearly gates. It's not even those close to him that may have passed on that he possibly might get to see. It's not the excitement of meeting the fathers of the faith. For Paul, the gain of heaven is the presence of Jesus Christ. To those maybe facing death in a very real way today, here this morning or watching online, maybe waiting to hear fatal news from the doctor or having already heard the news and are simply waiting until God takes you home. To those maybe facing death in a very real way, this verse is an absolute treasure. Paul, as he is encouraging the believers in Philippi, is encouraging us 2,000 years later with this truth. Death, for those that have put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ as Lord over their lives and have chosen to follow Jesus Christ, death for that person is not a tragedy, but a gain. Therefore, even in the possibility of death, there can be joy in Christ. Can you say this today? Can you say that to die is gain? If yes, there's no fear in death. If no, there's a strong possibility you need a new heart to put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, to put away your idols that you put before him, and to lean on him in everything, to center him around everything that you do. If yes, but lately you're not really putting him first, you can say that yes, to die is gain, but right now I'm not really putting him first in my life. Turn to him in his word daily and feast on the person of Jesus Christ. So Paul will experience joy because he is positive that his circumstances will turn out for his deliverance. Paul will experience joy because his purpose in life is Christ, and his profit in death is to be with Christ. Finally, Paul will experience joy because his persuasion is that living or dying are both good options. Paul will experience joy because his persuasion is that living or dying are both good options. We read in verses 22 through 26, "But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me. And I don't know which to choose. But I am hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that's very much better. Yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. Convinced of this, I will remain and continue with you, all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that your proud confidence in me may abound in Christ Jesus through my coming to you again. Paul here is presented with two options. He's really struggling intellectually to sort this out in his mind and heart about which is the better option or the one he would choose. He says that he's hard-pressed, which literally means to be closed in on both sides. It's a serious dilemma for Paul. For those of us that have seen Star Wars: A New Hope, the scene where Luke, Han, and Chewie and Princess Leia go down into the trash compactor and the walls start coming in. This kind of like hard-pressed from both sides, right? He just can't choose. They're both coming, oh, this is good, this is good. And then they're pressuring him. He's like, oh, I don't know. I don't know. To die is very much better. To live is to serve Christ. And he's legitimately having this dilemma in his mind and heart. His conclusion is that to go to be with Christ is very much better. And I like that phrase, because it's not just better for Paul, it's much better. And it's not just much better for Paul, it's very much better. However, he says that it's more necessary for them, for him to stay. And why is it necessary for Paul to stay? He explains it in the final verse of our passage. For their progress and joy. If he were to go and be with Christ, this would be for his personal progress and joy. But if he were to stay, it would be for the progress and joy of those he ministers to. The ESV renders the final verse like this: so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Why does Paul consider staying a good option? Because he will have the opportunity to lead others and teach others to glorify Christ. And these last four verses actually explain for us a bit of what Paul means by to live is Christ. He says in verse 24 that living, for Paul, is fruitful labor. Verse 24, he says, fruitful labor. If I'm going to live, it means fruitful labor. Paul will live to be used by Christ to encourage and exhort others to produce fruit for Christ. To live for Paul means fruitful labor. To live for Paul is also so that those he ministers to will progress and be filled with joy in Christ. As we read in verse 25, living for Christ then is to make much of him in every situation, pointing others to him in all we do. Paul is essentially saying here that if he lives, then he has good work to do for the glory of Christ. Paul believes if he survives, then this means that God still has gospel work for him to do. If he lives, then he will be used by Christ. And for Paul, this is also a delight. If you're breathing, there is gospel work to be done on earth. We can retire from the classroom. We can graduate from any school or university. We can retire from our jobs, but we can never retire from our God-given purpose of serving him until he takes us home at the end of life. And it's regardless of your age. You could be in your tens, your teens, your 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 80s, 90s. It doesn't matter how old you are. We are to sprint to the finish. In the face of difficult circumstances, this is where Paul found his joy. He could rejoice because he was positive or confident that his circumstances would turn out for his deliverance. He was confident in the sovereignty of God. He could rejoice because his purpose in life is Christ. He could rejoice because his profit in death is Christ. And he could rejoice because his persuasion is that living and dying are both good options. I pray that we, together, individually and collectively, will be able to say sincerely that to live is Christ and to die is gain. Let's pray together. Now, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you've revealed to us who you are in your word, and the relationship with you is possible. Lord, I pray for the coronavirus that it stops spreading, but also for those of us that maybe fear death and are crippled by the fear of death, can rely in the promise of your word and your deliverance, whether in this life or the next. So God, I pray that this will be our confession, that to live is Christ and to die is gain. Pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you'd like to stand and join us in our final song.
Take a second to respond in prayer to the sermon. One of the things that jumped out to me is Paul's purpose in life is Christ. To live is Christ. We can tell what we're really living for by what we think about all the time, or what we're doing, what we give the majority of our time to. And if it isn't Christ, then many times what we'll see is that we lack the joy that we're meant to have regardless of our circumstances. Paul is facing death, but yet he can continue to rejoice. And so when we're not living, really living, giving our all, our thoughts, our time, then we lack the fruit that Paul had, including the fruit in the lives of others. And so I think for me, as I was listening, I felt really challenged to kind of recenter, to really start to give my mind and my time in a greater capacity to God, to Christ. So living would truly be Christ. It wouldn't be spending time on the internet or wasting time or thinking about the future, worrying, but living for him. And so if we could make that our prayer right now, that for us individually, confess where we haven't been living for Christ, our mind, our thoughts haven't been wrapped up in him or wrapped up in his purpose and his kingdom, our time hasn't been devoted to those things. If you could spend some time confessing that individually, confessing that corporately as a church and at Hundong, and pray that that would truly be what our purpose is individually as a church and Hundong. Let's pray for us to live it, live for Christ. The other thing that jumped out to me, as I already mentioned, the fruit of living for Christ is the joy that comes from Christ. Same thing we really see in Galatians 5, talked about in the Holy Spirit. 5:16, walk in the Spirit. And then 5:22 talks about one of the fruits of the Spirit is joy. When I'm really living or walking in the Spirit, then I'll have joy. And so if we could pray right now, this is a time frame because of disruptions in plans, disruptions in hope, circumstances changing, that people lack joy, more prone to discouragement, anxiety, worries, fear, depression. If we could pray right now that for each one of us, that we would increase in our joy that comes from Christ, comes from the Holy Spirit, regardless of our circumstances. Pray that God would set people free from depression, anxiety, worry, that as we recenter our lives on Christ, that we would have joy, the joy of the Holy Spirit. And so right now, begin to pray for that for yourself. Confess where you haven't had it, and pray that we would have it, and pray that others would have it in this season where our circumstances may not be ideal, that God would increase our joy as we focus more on Christ. Let's pray for that. Finally, the last thing that Paul says is, he says, I will remain for your progress in the faith and your joy. That because Paul was living for Christ and reaping the joy that came from that relationship, he could be used to help others progress in knowing Christ more and progress in having joy, regardless of their circumstance. That's God's will for us as well, to help people progress in their faith and progress in the joy that comes from their relationship with Christ. And so if we could pray for that for ourselves individually this semester, as a student, as a professor, as a teacher, as a businessman, that God would use us to help our coworkers, help our family, help our children to progress in the faith, but also have joy regardless of circumstances. If you could pray for that for our classes this semester at Handong, at HIS, our chapels, would increase the faith of our students. And those that don't know Christ would begin to truly live. They'd be alive as they're born again. Those new students and new professors, there would be new life on our campus and joy that comes regardless of circumstance. So pray for God to use HIC and its small groups, to use the worship team, use our children's ministry. Pray for God to use our professors and our students, HIS. Let's pray for God to use us to help people progress in the faith this semester and progress in their joy regardless of their circumstances. Let's make that our prayer. This for ourselves, to help people progress in the faith and have joy. Let's make this our intercession for the church here in Korea, in the workplace, in the business, in their homes. bringing people to Christ, helping Christians to know the Word of God more and be set free from strongholds, helping people have joy, that God has placed His church as salt sprinkled throughout Korea, sprinkled throughout the world as light to help people have faith and to help people have joy. Listen to right now, make that our prayer for the church in Korea. Make that the prayer for the church throughout the world. We'll do the chorus again and then we'll close as we make this our prayer. Declare that you are worthy. Father, you're worthy of all of our honor. You're worthy of all of our energy. You're worthy of all of our body, Lord, all that we have, Father. We just declare right now, you're worthy. And we ask, Lord, that you would, by your grace, bring glory to yourself through our lives. That you may be honored, that you may be magnified, whether in life, whether in death, whether in class, whether in summertime, whatever we do, whether we're resting, Father, you would be glorified and magnified in these bodies that you have made to be your temples. And so we ask that be true of every one of us here at HIC and every one of us on this campus, Lord. We ask that be true of your church throughout the world where that's receiving a lot of slander and persecution. Would allow them to shine as lights, helping people to come to a saving faith in you and believers to progress in their faith and to have joy in a world that's marked by sin and division and death, that we can have joy and help others have joy. We thank you, Father, for being with us. We do want to pray for this coming semester, Father, Lord. Many of us are about to enter it with fear and trepidation. We ask for a special anointing upon all of our students, especially those that are new, that you give them grace to adjust, give them grace to get in a church family where they're hearing the word of God preach and they're growing in Christ. If that be your will, we ask that you give them to us. We ask, dear Father, for a special anointing for our professors and our teachers at HIS to serve with joy as though they're serving you regardless of difficulties and problems that come, dear Father, between one another, that we realize that we're ultimately serving you. And you're the one who rewards us, and you're the one who's pleased with us. And so, Father, go before us this semester and produce much fruit in our own lives as a church, much fruit in our campus, and much fruit throughout the world through using this pandemic and the various difficulties that we're going through as a nation and various nations. We ask that you would use it ultimately to bring glory to Christ. We love you, Father. We thank you for the ability to gather, both virtually and in person. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give our Father a hand clap. God, you're good. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Have a wonderful Lord's Day. God bless you.
Yeah.